guys had a rare, kind of somewhat late season out of conference weekend. What were your takeaways from the split with Classic Irvine?
I really liked big pieces of the weekend. The challenge to score is an ongoing one for us. Even in the 2-0 game, one of them is an empty netter, and the first one scored in a minute into the game. We're working for it. Like we're every single day we're trying to address the habits of trying to score, paying the price to score, finding different ways to score. Our defensive game has been really good. Our goaltending has been really good. Now it's just about finding that way to get different looks to score. So I guess the takeaways from the weekend were we did a lot of things we really were happy with. The second game, I thought we took our foot off the gas pedal for pieces of the game, and then it got away from us.
Obviously not a hockey East opponent. What did you be able to pull away from that series that was maybe different to help you guys move forward?
It's always nice to see colleagues, and I've never met Eric Largent from their team, for our players to see people they know just to play a different logo, not just the same ones you play all the time. I thought that was really interesting. It was good for the fans to see a new jersey in here. I think that Alaska Fairbanks is an excellent program, and they're on the road so much that you could see the character inside their game. They didn't give up either of the games. Like, they were right in that game in the first game. And then I thought that they just outworked us the second game, which to me is a real good sign of character. So I was personally pleased to make a new acquaintance in their head coach, Eric Largent, and for our players to play somebody else. Very similar situation to where we are right now. They're trying to build something, and they're trying to make their own identity, and I think they're doing a heck of a job. It was a lot of fun.
Both of your teams, very international rosters. Is that something that you notice watching on the ice?
The only way I saw that really, Frank, was looking at the lineup and then recognizing that there wasn't a lot of guys named Frank or Todd on the roster, and figuring out, they got players from Latvia, they got players from Sweden, they got players from Finland and all over the world similar to us. I think when you're not the traditional powerhouse in NCAA hockey that we are yet, obviously I can't speak for Alaska Fairbanks, you're going to have to look outside the normal window of where you're going to find your players, and recognizing that we might not win a slugfest for a player down in Boston, but if we're connected in Latvia, we're connected in Sweden or Finland or Germany or whatever it is, those are places we can get good players. That's where we're trying to find our skill. And if you look at the skill inside of our team, so much of it is young skill. Spitzerov from Russia is coming. You're seeing Reva Tolins, who's a Latvian, Isaac Walther, who, while he hasn't scored as a Swede, I look at him and see a Swede playing a North American game, how hard and heavy is Joel Matta, who's coming on as a player. And that's just several of the guys that are international players for us, Luka Munzenberger. And a big piece of our international roster is Andre Bujalski, who after the third game was gone for the whole season. And he was a guy that we've been counting on to be an offensive player for us. So it's one sense it's good for us, because next year he's technically going to be a freshman. He's able to come in, use this as a red shirt. And he's going to know everything about the school and life, and we'll be able to use him. So I think that when you have two teams that are in similar situations and building players and trying to find skill and people who could score and contribute all over the ice, you're going to look all over the world. It really is a global game now.
Offensively, what do you think it's going to take to be able to put that switch this season?
I think, honestly, Marshy, that it comes down to maturity and experience. We're getting chances, we're getting offensive chances. We've gone against some great goaltending, but that's life. You're going to go against great goalies. Nobody's going to give you free goals. It's got to be a worker's attitude here. We have to work for our offense. We're not going to be a team that's going to have the Alex Ovechkin-type shots, the Backstrom-type passes. We're going to be a team that works inside the dots. Every rink in the world, I guess it's kind of germane to what we're talking about. Every rink in the world, there's 9 dots. I can see everybody right now counting it because they're forgetting the one at center ice. And the distance inside the dots is the exact same, whether you're in Vermont or whether you're in Japan or China or Saskatoon or Virginia. It's always the exact same inside the dots. Outside the dots is where the game is different for international players. A lot of times it's bigger ice. But if you can be a team that learns how to be strong inside the dots, offensively and defensively, I think your team has a lot bigger chance of scoring. It's hard. It's really hard to score, and we want our players to know that. That's why we're so happy our young players, our new players, are getting such heavy minutes and experience. They're seeing how hard it is. Now they're going to be able to go in the offseason, figure out how they have to get stronger and faster, and figure out ways to score, because it's not going to get easier. It's only going to get harder.
You guys have seen a team you saw pretty recently.
Yeah, we don't like these guys.
Can you speak a little bit about that?
Well, we don't like anybody except ourselves. It's a good example for us about living in the present. Like, we're not so hung up on the wins and losses and how we've been against, especially these big, strong, really good teams like Northeastern. We're trying to worry about, like, the present, what we're going to do today against a team like Northeastern. So we got them coming in 2 days. We're actually going to go see them. We don't like them solely for the fact that the games are very hard and physical and tough and strong, and that's exactly what fans want to see, and we're happy to try to put that product on the ice too. And back to the young guys, like, they're seeing, to get to the big dance, to be able to play in TD Garden, you got to get through the Northeasterns and the BUs and the UMass and UMass Lowell's, all the good teams in hockey. They're all the teams in Hockey East are good. So I'm excited that we get to play them. I'm excited that we have the adversity of a Friday night and then a Saturday night in a second city taking on another great opponent in Providence, because that's the experience these guys need. We know, we're aware of who we are right now, and we're just trying to make sure that the young guys and all the players have a chance to see if you can get through these teams, you can get through anybody.
The women's team, obviously, Northeastern knocked off
awesome.
In the country. They're rolling like never before. But again, against Northeastern,
yeah.
Are you able to use that, or how are you able to use that as motivation for your guys?
Our teams are pretty connected. I think with Jim Plumer and his staff, and our players are so friendly with the athletes on the women's team. We're cheering for all their Olympic athletes. For us to try to emulate what they're doing against Northeastern, absolutely. We got to shake the cobwebs out of our own game first right now. I'm not so worried about trying to do what other teams are doing except win. And they're setting a really good example. How hard, you can hear right now how hard they're working on the ice. And I think they're doing an awesome job. And you're seeing the fruits of that just by how many athletes they have in the Olympics right now. So we're so proud of them. We're proud to be partners with them. Proud to wear the same logo with them, and just looking forward, maybe we can do the same thing against Northeastern on Friday night and then Providence on Saturday.
As a coach, what do you try and learn every time you play teams of that caliber?
So I guess there's probably a couple different depths to that. Like, I want to see how teams play us, like, because I'm going to use that the next time. So we just played Northeastern very recently, so most of the video we use will be us against them. So trying to see how they try to counter us tactically, what they're trying to do to get through our neutral zone, or how they try to score against us, or what they're trying to exploit. Because then when I see them, I can see the holes in our game from another coach's lens. That'd probably be the first thing, and maybe the deepest part of the answer. The other thing is, you can always learn just from watching. So I like to watch Northeastern's offense, how they create, how they have their D involved, their D surfing all over the offensive zone, how hard that is for our players to mark them and find them. We at some point we'll be able to do that. We'll have the players to be able to do that. I think when you see young coaches like Jerry Keefe and a guy like Nate Lehman in Providence, like, these are innovative coaches. I'm always going to be learning from those guys. So we'd probably need about a four-hour miniseries to see how much I'm learning from these guys. They're certainly not learning anything from me right now, that's for sure. Every game we've played against them since I've been here have been really tight, and ones we could have won. Even going back to last year, there's a 1-0. You know, we got jobbed in front of the net at the end of the game. We had a penalty shot that didn't get called. Like, what are you going to do about it? You're not going to cry about it. You got to come back and keep trying to win. And we go up against them 3-0 this year, and just the inexperience of some of our players to understand, if you're up 3-0, you don't hit a guy that could potentially be a 5-minute major that might end up feeding the number one of the power play unit in Hockey East at that time. So these are lessons for us. They're hard lessons for us. We would not be a better team if we didn't try to take something from those lessons. And I think when you go against a team like Providence, and I guess really, Jack, we do have to pay attention to that game on Saturday night because the turnaround is so fast. So usually the process after a game, especially if you play the same team twice, is the game's over. Eric Ellens, our video coach, puts the games on our laptop. We go through the game, we do like a surgery of the game, and then you can use those clips the next night. We don't have the luxury of doing that. They're playing Friday night as well. We have to travel to Providence, so I'm going to have to get their game as quick as I can Friday night. Let's say we get to the hotel at 11:30, then you got to go through the game. That's about a three and a half hour process to see what they're doing, trying to pick even one small thing you can use to your advantage and try to use that the next night. So I'm looking forward to it, but I'm also kind of dreading it too.
Northeastern started goalie Kevin Lee, but Canada, I think,
prepare for the two goalie, you probably don't have video on and you don't have a lot of experience.
Yeah, I mean, a big part of the goaltending is the players that are in front of them defensively, so we understand their defensive structure. We know that Northeastern is going to be doing every single thing they can to help him get a win this year for, you know, to get his career even stronger. We're aware of that. There is video on everybody, so I can find video on you if you like on the internet. It might not be great video, but there's video of everybody. So we're able to do pre-scouting. Drew Michaels, who works at our goalies, does an unbelievable job of just going through the internet and finding something on these guys. And it might not be an 11-minute highlight video we have of a goalie. And I can't even say highlight, more of a snapshot of that goalie, how that goalie plays, what they give up, where their chances are coming from, how we can look for vulnerabilities in their game. So there is video. Now it's just incumbent on Drew Michaels and the rest of the staff to go through it, present it to the players in a coherent message. And then really, to be honest, it's about our game. Like, we're going to find offense if we're going to find it through working for it. So I think that is kind of going to be the theme for the weekend.
After it came out that you weren't going to be going to China anymore with the Swedes, well, you said you might still have some involvement here.
Yeah.
Now that it's here, what is that involvement?
Well, they just got on a plane today, so they. I've had conversations with the coaching staff. I've given them some ideas. Like, I'm especially against the North American teams, the Canadians and Americans, I'm pretty fluent in the players. So I'll be able to share my ideas on them. I'm going to watch the game from afar for them and just give my opinion surgically, in the sense that I'm not right there. I'm not in the heat of the emotion. So I'll be able to give some thoughts after the game. Hey, here's some areas that maybe if I was looking to exploit Sweden, this is what I would look to do. Or, hey, we're going to play against Latvia, for instance. What do we need to do against Latvia? But a lot of that work's actually been done. Latvia and Slovakia specifically, their national team is not going to change much from the summer, so we did a big project in August and September, so a lot of that work's already been done.
Yeah, excuse the expression, but is that just like out of the goodness of your own heart, or is that something they're expecting of you?
I'm friends with all those guys, right? So it'd be the same if anybody asked me to help them. If my old team asked me to help them, I would do the exact same thing. So I guess maybe it is out of the goodness of my heart. If I have any good in my heart, maybe that's what I do. I have a tendency not to say no to anybody, so I think that probably explains why I'm losing my hair right now.
Just one more Olympic question. Yeah. What are some of the biggest storylines or matchups that you're looking forward to in China?
Well, I'm so excited for the women's Olympics. Absolutely, to watch our players from UVM to play there. I can't wait to watch Sini play with Finland and all the Czechs to play. I'm so excited about that. Even to have a couple future commits coming, I read today, which is really exciting. I'm a big fan of the women's game, so I know the Canadian and the USA game, that's going to be a war. I'm pretty excited about that. And then I think just with on the men's side, I'm just going to be watching Sweden and cheering on Sweden as much as I can, doing whatever I can to support them, whatever they need me to do. They're 13 hours ahead, so I don't know how much they're going to want my opinion at 1 o'clock in the morning.